Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Last week, we're looking at the consequences of the hijrah al-ula, the first hijrah, or hijrah to Thania, and the second hijrah of the Muslims to Abyssinia. And we said the cause of the first hijrah was due to the persecution of the Quraysh of the Muslims and the torturing and the killing of the Muslims. And the second hijrah that they made was because they came back from the first hijrah, because there was a rumor that the whole of Quraysh, they had accepted Islam due to an incident that happened with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he was reciting the Quran. He went into sujood, and all of the Quraysh, they went into sujood with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now after the second hijrah, the mushrikeen, they increased in their harms and their persecution of the Muslims. Because when they went to Habasha to bring them back, and Najashi refused to send the Muslims back with them, this enraged the mushrikeen, the polytheists. So they increased in their torture and their persecution. But like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna ma'al usri yusra." After hardship comes ease. Every time there was hardship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings ease. And after their persecution increased, due to their persecution, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought ease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought ease through the Islam of who? Hamza radiallahu ta'ala an, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And afterwards, through the Islam of who? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. And at that moment, a dynamic change happened. The Muslims could go to the Kaaba, open Allah subhanahu, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala openly, walk to the Kaaba and sit at the Kaaba without anybody disturbing them in the presence of Umar and the presence of Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. So this was a magnificent victory, a dynamic change for the Muslims. At this point, the Quraysh, realizing that the strength that the Muslims had, they had no choice after this but to come to a compromise. So they used to come to with compromises to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first of the compromises was, they sent Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. They sent the most noble of Al-Quraysh, not anybody from Quraysh, to go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and make compromises. So the first compromise was, they said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if it's leadership you want, we'll make you our leader. If it's women that you want, we'll marry you 10 of our women. If it's wealth that you want, we'll give you all of our wealth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously he refused this. Then they came with a second compromise. They said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let's worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to a shift pattern. Meaning, this year, we worship Allah with you, no problem. And next year, you worship our idols with us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he rejected this. And then they came with a third compromise. And that third compromise was this, that they said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the first compromise failed, the second compromise failed, they said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, okay, we accept Islam, we listen to you. But we could not sit with these low people of society, the slaves, the freed slaves, just us around you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused this. So now that all doors have been locked of compromise, and they could not bribe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went back to what they knew the best, which was what? Persecution of the Muslims. But with this persecution now, it was even more severe. And as severe as it was, Abu Talib, he felt and he sensed that this persecution this time is not going to be like the previous persecutions. And it's going to be so severe, he will not have the strength or the power to defend the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by himself. So Abu Talib, he called for a meeting. He called the whole tribe of Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib for a meeting. And he took from them in that meeting a covenant and a promise and a decree that no matter what the Quraysh they do to them, they should never surrender Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the whole of Banu Hashim, Banu Muttalib, because they're cousins, because Abdul Manaf had four sons, Hashim, Muttalib, Nawfal, and Abdul Shams. From these four, the closest two to each other were who? Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about these two, that ما فرقناهم لا في الجاهلية ولا في الإسلام. We were never separated in Jahiliyyah or Islam. And Banu Nawfal and Banu Abd al-Shams were always close to each other. So he gathered Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib together, and they signed an agreement, and they gave their confidence and their word that no matter what the Quraysh they do, will never surrender the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to them. And this covenant that was signed not only by the Muslims of Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib, in fact, by the Mushrikeen, by the polytheists, non-Muslims, Kuffar, and the majority of them were what? Were Kuffar. The majority that signed this, that they will never give up the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the whole of Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib, they signed this agreement, except for one person from Banu Hashim, from exact tribe of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Lahab. He said, this one, I'm not going to sign. And he went with Banu Makhzum, Banu Adi, Banu Abdushans, Banu Nawfal. He took their side. That as for me, I'll give him up. So they all signed it except for Abu Lahab. After signing this agreement, Abu Jahl, who is the Fir'aun of this Ummah, he realized this latest development is a dangerous development. Things have taken a new twist. If it were just Abu Talib and Banu Hashim, they could handle it. But now you got Banu Hashim, Banu Muttalib, the Mushrikeen, the Muslims. He realized this is a dangerous turn now. So he called for a meeting in the compound of Banu Kinana. And he called all of the different tribes, because all the tribes of Quraysh, they come from these brothers, these four main brothers. So he called all the other tribes other than Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib. That the only thing we could do now is to come out with a qarar, which is khatir, a resolution. A resolution which will break Banu Hashim. Not a resolution, a decree of war. We cannot fight them. But a resolution that will break their resolve completely. We're going to come out with a bid'ah, an innovation that's never been practiced before amongst the Arabs, ever. And that innovation that he came out with, for the first time in the history of the Arabs, Abu Jahl and the rest of the other tribes came out with this innovation. And that innovation was the innovation of blockade, sanction, and to put people under siege. He said, we're going to put upon them an embargo. And this embargo that they put upon them was not only an economical embargo that they put upon Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib. From this embargo, to show it was not just economical, they say that every single tribe should sign this agreement, this resolution. And the leaders will represent their people, the leaders of the different tribe. And from that resolution they came up with was, they say that as for Banu Muttalib and Banu Hashim, that we will not marry our daughters to them, nor would we allow anybody to marry them. وَأَلَّا يُبَايِعُونَهُمْ, and nobody should trade or sell to them or buy from them. And nobody يُخَالِطُونَهُمْ, that nobody should even mix with them. So firstly, no marriages between them. Secondly, no trade between them. Thirdly, you could not mix with them. وَلَا يُجَالِسُونَهُمْ, nobody from any other tribe is even allowed to sit with them. Also, وَلَا يَدْخُلُونَ فِي بُيُوتِهِمْ, they're not allowed to even enter their houses. And also, وَلَا يُكَلِّمُونَهُمْ, don't even speak to them. Not only don't only speak to them, and he went, وَلَا يَقَبَلُونَ مِنْهُمْ صُلْحًا أَبَدًا, don't ever accept any treaty from them. And the worst of it all, وَلَا تَأْخُذُهُمْ, subhanAllah. This kind of embargoes are not new. The last thing they said, وَلَا تَأْخُذُهُمْ رَأْفَةً, even to have sympathy and empathy and pity is illegal. Have you not heard of such an embargo before? Even pity, sympathy upon them as human beings, it becomes illegal. And not just human beings, these are their cousins that they're going to put these embargoes on. Even the sympathy and empathy is illegal. You're not allowed to have sympathy or empathy or pity. This was the sanction of jahili, of the juhala, of the mushrikeen, subhanallah. And look at the sanctions of today likewise. These are the worst of the mushrikeen, and this is what they came out with. And people today could come out with the same sanction. Even pity and empathy became what? Illegal. You're not allowed to show pity, no mercy. So when they came out with this, they said, until they surrendered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said that the person that wrote this treaty, Ikrimah ibn al-Harith, and some say his name was Nadr ibn al-Harith, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam da'a alayhi, that the Prophet made dua against him, فَشُلَّتْ بَعْضْ أَصَابِعًا, and some of his fingers became paralyzed after writing this contract. When they wrote this contract and agreed to this decree and this resolution, the Muslims, because you can't marry from them, you can't trade with them, you can't do anything with them, they were all forced, with the whole of Banu Hashim, Banu Muttalib, all these two tribes were forced to go to where? The Shi'ab, the valleys of Abu Talib, and stay there. So they stayed under this blockade, this embargo, in the Shi'ab Abu Talib. And to show how severe this blockade was, forget the blockade we're going through right now, that okay, we can't get Cheetos anymore, or Doritos, as some people will complain. This blockade was so severe that the Quraysh, they used to hear the crying of women and children from the valleys of Abu Talib. They used to hear the screaming of the women and the children that were screaming and crying out of what? Severe hunger. And this screaming and this crying, if you hear it just once and you don't hear it again, you can say, okay, maybe, you know, they forgot about this. This screaming and this crying of the women and the children continued for 3 years. This embargo lasted 3 years, summer and winter, and it continued. But the difference with their embargo, their sanction, and the sanction we have today was, the Arabs, they used to respect Ashhurul Hurum, those holy months, the months of Hajj, month of Ramadan, Muharram. So when it came to these months, subhanAllah, look at this, as wicked as they were, when it came to the holy months, they'll break the contract. Say, the Muslims come out and trade with us. Subhanallah. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. That the mushrikeen, they honored these months to say, you know what? You are enemies. We put embargo upon you, but during these holy months, la. And these are mushrikeen. So the Muslims, during these holy months, will come out of the valley Abu Talib to go and buy from the traders that came to Makkah. But it still made it difficult for them. So if the Muslim goes and buys from the caravan to take back to the Shi'ab, the Valley Abu Talib, a caravan for 1,000 dirham, the mushrikeen from the other tribes, from the nobles, will say, I'll buy for 2,000. If the Muslims say, okay, 3,000, they say 4,000. They made it more expensive for them and made it more difficult for them, subhanAllah, to show this kind of blockade, this kind of sanction or siege, it's not new, that they will pay the highest money to make sure the Muslims suffer. So they couldn't take back to the valley much with them because they increased the price upon them. But however, during these only months, they allowed them. They allowed them. So they couldn't take much back with them anyway. So people like Hakim ibn Hizam, who is the nephew of Khadijah radiallahu ta'ala anha, he used to take whatever he could take for her and sneak food to her. Whatever he could sneak, from flowers and wheat, whatever little he could. But it was very little. And the rest of the people from the mushrikeen of Banu Muttalib, Banu Hashim, and the Muslims, they had nothing at all. Zero. That they used to say that one of us, yaqdi hajatahu, one of us will go to relieve himself, go to the toilet or the bathroom. And whilst relieving himself, from the drops of the urine, he hears a sound, ta ta ta. And he looks beneath him and you see a piece of leather. He's urinating on a piece of leather. He will pick up the piece of leather, wash it, scrape it, boil it, and eat it. That's how severe that sanction was. Some of them used to eat from the leaves of the tree. Sa'ad ibn Abu Waqqas, radiallahu anhu, who later on became from the richest of Sahaba, after the victory and the conquest, was narrating his own story. He said, Wallahi wa taqtu shay'an fi shi'ab. Sa'ad ibn Abu Waqqas said, in those days, I stepped on something in the shi'ab, in the valley of Abu Talib. تحت قدمي, under my feet. فأخذته فأكلته. I picked it up and I ate it. He said, إِلَى الْآنْ مَا أَدْرِ مَا هُ. He said, until this day, I don't even know what I ate, but I just ate it. To show the severe hunger and the sufferings of the Muslim in the Shi'ab during this embargo and the mushrikeen. And the mushrikeen, they could have just said, you know what, this is their issue. But the Arabs of the past, their chivalry in braveness and courage, that when they gave their word, they never broke their word. And from their principles we mentioned last week is, أَنَا وَأَخِي عَلَى إِبْنُ عَمِّي. Me and my brother against my cousin. وَأَنَا وَإِبْنُ عَمِّي عَلَى الْغَرِيبِ. And me and my cousin will always be against a stranger. They will never let an outsider destroy them or divide them. So the mushrikeen, they suffered like the Muslims suffered in the Sheikh Abu Talib. So this continued and continued and continued until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided five of the Quraysh. These five of the Quraysh that Allah ta'ala guided, He didn't guide them towards al-Islam, but He guided them towards mercy, sympathy, humanity, and that natural feeling, hamiyatu jahiliyyah, that these are our cousins. And these five that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided from al-Quraysh to try to break the contract are Hisham ibn Amr, who was from Bani Hashim. Also Zuhair ibn Umayyah, who was from Banu al-Makhzum. Thirdly, was Mut'im ibn Adi. Fourthly, was Abu Bukhtari ibn Hisham. And fifthly, was Zuma'a ibn Aswad. Allah Ta'ala guided these five towards mercy and sympathy. And the first to start the movement was Hisham ibn Amr. The Hisham ibn Amr, seeing what was happening to his cousin, felt so hurt. He started to go to the rest of these five, or rest of these four, one by one by one. And he went to them and he said to them, Hisham, one by one. Then he went to Mut'im, first and foremost. And he said, Afwan, he went to Zuhair, first and foremost. And he said to Zuhair, that, Ya Zuhair, are you pleased and ta'kul ta'am? Are you happy to be eating food? Wa talbas al-thiyab, and to be dressing in clothing? Wa tankih al-nisa, and to marry women? And your cousins are in a situation which you know of right now. How could you be happy? So he hit him, Zuhair. And Zuhair went to a third person. Then he went to a fourth and a fifth. It became five. And they came up with a plan to break this oppressive blockade, this oppressive sanction. And they came up with a strategy. And that strategy was, Zuhair, he said, we're going to go to the Kaaba tomorrow. And I'm going to speak first. And although I'm going to speak first, we're going to place ourselves strategically in different positions. In different positions, and we're not going to speak at once, so it may be seen as we're together, we planned this before. So the next day, they went to the Kaaba. And Zuhair, who said he's going to speak first, he was dressed in a bisht, you know, the cloak that he used to wear. And he did a tawaf. فَطَوَفَ بِالْبَيْتِ سَبْعًا. He did tawaf around the house of Allah Azza wa Jalla 7 times. ثُمَّ أَقْبَلَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. Then he turned to the Quraysh with the loudest of his voice. And he said, يَا أَهْلَ مَكَّةِ. O people of Mecca. أَنَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامِ وَلْنَلْبَسُ الثِّيَابِ وَبَنُ هَاشِمْ هَلْكَ عَفْوًا. He said, are we going to eat food, drink, dress, and Banu Hashim are perishing? لَا يُبَعْ وَلَا يُبْتَاعُ مِنْهُمْ. We cannot self buy from them, nor can they buy from us. He said, Wallahi, la aq'ud hatta, I will not sit down hatta tushaqqu hadhihi as-sahifa al-qati'a al-zalima. He said, I will not sit down until this sahifa, because that contract they wrote, the different tribes, they wrote it on a piece of paper. And for them to show the holiness of this contract, they put that contract or that covenant and the rest in the inside the Kaaba. Inside the Kaaba. He said, I will not sit down until this sahifa, this piece of paper, covenant, resolution, whatever you wrote, whatever you call it, which is qati'a, which is to cut links or break ties, as they say today. That this sahifa al-qati'a, this sahifa to break ties, al-zalima, oppressive, one, it is broken completely. At this point, Abu Jahl was in the corner of the masjid. Abu Jahl stood up in rage, said, Wallahi la tashaqqu. By Allah, you're not going to break this contract. He said, at this moment, you're not going to break the contract. The second person stood up, strategically, as though they were not together. They stood up in another corner, and this was Zam'a ibn al-Aswad. He said, Anta Wallahi Abu Jahl akthab. Because Abu Jahl, he said, Zuhair is a liar. So he said, Anta Wallahi, by Allah, you're more of a liar. He said to Abu Jahl, as he stood up, the third person, Abu al-Bukhtari, he stood up. He said, Sadaqa Abu Zam'a. Like, they're not together. He said, Abu Zam'a, he spoke the truth, to be honest. And then the fourth person stood up. And that was Mut'im ibn Adi. He said, Sadaqtuma. That you both have spoken to the truth. That we are free from this decree or this resolution. وَمِمَّا كُتِبَ فِيهَا. And whatever is written in it. And then Hisham ibn Amr, he said the same thing. He said the same thing. And they went on to say, we're not pleased in the first place with this contract. We're not pleased with this resolution. At this point, Abu Jahl, he stood up and he said, هذا أمر قضي بالليل. Look at the intelligence of Abu Jahl. He said to the rest of Quraysh, they planned this already. هذا أمر, they planned this last night. They didn't just come, هذا أمر قضي بالليل. They planned this from last night. At this point, a struggle ensued between both parties. And at that moment, Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was sitting in the corner of the masjid. He said to them, because Mut'im, he decided to go in the Kaaba and rip it apart. Abu Talib stood up and he said to them, that look, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has sent me to you to tell you there's an ayah, there's a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this sign from Allah azza wa jal, Prophet received it through wahi, revelation. That whatever they've written from the Sahifa is all been eaten up completely by termites. So Abu Talib said to them, if what he is saying is true, we break the contract. If he is lying, you continue upon this resolution on this blockade. So when they went inside the Kaaba and they took the Sahifa, every single part of it was eaten up, except for one part, which was, this is become Allah in the name of Allah. That's the only part the termites have eaten. So at this point, the blockade was broken completely, the embargo of the Muslims. But, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the third kabunna, that you go to life, tabaqan and tabaqan. Life in stages and stages. Meaning there will be ease, there will be hardship. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa tilka al-ayyam, and such are the days, and there will be that. But exchanging of Muslims, one day you can do, one day they did. So after this blockade was lifted and the siege was lifted upon the Muslims, in the 10th year of the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, after the Nubuwwah, the Prophet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, 6 months after the blockade had been lifted, Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, became very sick. He became old and sick, he was completely bedridden. He passed the age of 80. So the mushrikeen knew this was an opportune moment to go to Abu Talib. So they went to Abu Talib to convince him of another treaty. And the reason they had to do this was, if Abu Talib was to pass away and started to persecute the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they feared for their honor and their pride that they would be said, we don't need to do this, let's go for that. So out of pride and honor, they wanted the treaty before Abu Talib passed away. So they went to Abu Talib and they said to Abu Talib, listen, your nephew, we're going to leave. So long as it is us. Let him do his da'wah, go to Allah Azza wa Jal. What? Does not mention the force of our God. And that's not possible. We didn't need that. The opposite of something means what that thing is more clear. So if you want to know what God is, or what happens, you have to know force with it. You have to know force with it. And that's why the shahada that we say every single day, it contains both negation and affirmation. You cannot get preferred to Allah Azza wa Jal. So Abu Talib called upon sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with this new offering of Quraysh, new offering, that you do your da'wah. Don't mention their gods and you'll leave him alone. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Abu Talib, ma uridu minhum siwa kalimat. I do not want anything from them but a kalimat, which is the word. Abu Talib, he narrated, he mentioned this to the rest of Quraysh, Abu Jahl and his party. And they were in the presence of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, wa abi mu'tika ashara. By your father, we'll give you 10. Get one, we'll give you 10. Not just one, we'll give you 10. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, qul la ilaha illallah. Say that, Abu Jahl. Say no. This one, no. Any other 10, but la ilaha illallah, never. So they stood up and they went. So now Abu Talib, he increased in his unit. And the Quraysh felt, and the sense that Abu Talib, and as we mentioned in the past, I think we are studying about good company, the importance of good company. And also we mentioned in the class of Philip on Tuesday on Janaiz, the term of Janaiz, that when a person is sent that is passing the term, that it is a good idea to be there to
have righteous people around me, people of knowledge, at that last moment. So then sensing Abu Talib went to pass away, they took advantage of this. Abu Jahl was there. Abdullah ibn Abu Umayyah was there, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was also there. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be at the head of Abu Talib, and he said, Ya Ammi, قُلْ لَا إِلَىٰ إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةً وَحَاجُ بِهَا لَكَ بِهَا بِكْرَ وَحَاجُ. He said, Oh Ammi, say, لَا إِلَىٰ إِلَىٰ The word, I can argue, لَكَ بِهَا بِكْرَ I can use to argue for your sake in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just say, لَا إِلَىٰ إِلَىٰ Abu Talib, every time he wanted to say it, the two other shaytan, Abu Jahl and Abdullah ibn Abu Umayyah, this is a tarah, al-millat al-Abu Talib. He couldn't go away or deviate from the millat of Abu Talib. So Abu Talib was. The Prophet of Allah said, La ilaha illallah, say La ilaha illallah. And the last thing Abu Talib he passed away on was, when his soul left him, ala millat al-Abu Talib. Now the fact that they said Abu Jahl and Abdullah ibn Abu Umayyah that he wants to deviate from the ways of Abu Talib is to show that the way of Abu Talib is nowhere to be. So those who say Abu Talib passed away upon Islam because Abu Talib was Ahlul Fitra, they're incorrect. They're totally incorrect. Because this is what Abu Jahl is pushing towards. So Abu Talib, the last thing he died upon was shirk. He died upon kufr. He didn't die as a Muslim. After this incident was extremely sad for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he broke the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The same way he breaks the heart of every single Muslim. To know that Abu Talib he passed other than Islam. To the point that Abu Talib if he even is confused and what didn't he? Wish we would love if Abu Talib become a believer. It's considered because of that we would have loved if he died as a believer. After this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Amma ana la astaghfiru lak. As for me, I will continue to ask Allah ta'ala to believe. Ma lam kunta alim. So long as Abu Talib is prohibited from doing so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala later on will be saying that it's not befitting. Ma kari lil nabi wal ladina amanu. It's not befitting for the Prophet or the believer. And he has to seek forgiveness for the mushrikeen. وَلَوْ كَانُوا لِكُرْبَ Even if it's the closest of your kids, the closest of your relatives, this is not permissible. So what about the person who is the closest of your kids? Or your relative? Well, how about you? Like recently, a fellow scientist passed away. A Muslim who commented on Facebook, may Allah have mercy on him. May Allah accept all of us. Not only was he a mushrik, Kafir, it was a polygamy, it was an atheist that challenged the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have Muslims, all the Muslims got to say no. We're allowed to say no, have mercy on Allah. We cannot say he's not a Muslim, we make his dua. So Allah ta'ala says it's not permissible. Min ba'di ma tabayyana lahum. After he's been made clear for them, and then who's have a jahil, then people of the hellfire, it's not permissible. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't do anything for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You cannot guide whoever you love, like as whoever goes. And this is an important aspect of tawheed. That from tawheed is that the only person that guides is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the whole of mankind, the whole of jinn, is to guide an individual, if Allah has not permitted for him to be guided, he will never be guided. Not only does it affirm our tawheed, is also a comfort for the souls of the believers. For some of us that are Muslim family that cannot practice it, or even non-Muslim family, that we try our best to guide them, that if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is on who defended al-Islam, he cannot guide them to al-Islam, what about us? So those who say Muhammad will be there, that Abu Talib, they call him Mu'min al-Quraish, the believer of the Quraish, that people will be there, and then he uses reasoning. From these people recently that said, Abu Talib is a believer, it's all reasoning. He said, it doesn't make sense to me. Whatever doesn't make sense to me, it cannot make sense to me. And what the thing doesn't make sense is, Abu Sufyan is 5 and what he does, we ask. What is it the father Ibrahim died in the shrine? Can we ask this question? The son of Noah, the wife of Noah, the son, the wife of Lot. So they say it doesn't make sense to them that Abu Sufyan or Amr ibn al-As who persecuted Muslims died on his life. So the proper Aqeedah and the Sunnah Abu Talib, he died in the shrine, he died in the kufr. And this was extremely sad for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And for us to believe, we never said a believer. To the point that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, if he never died as a Muslim, when the father Abu Bakr al-Siddiq accepted Islam, which is good news and glad tidings of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, that we have accepted Islam, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to show the love of Abu Bakr. He said, I wish it was your uncle that accepted Islam place instead of your father. If he died as a Muslim, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq as the Prophet. So he knew that he died as a Muslim. 2 months after this, Abu Talib passed away in Rajab. 2 months after Rajab, which is Ramadan, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mother of the believer, Khadijah radiallahu anha, also passed away. So this year was known as Ram and the year of silence. And it is this year that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we look at next week, after looking at Qur’an,